Welcome to the Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Chapter 11, Build a Small Network, Part 2 of 2. Part 1, the link will be to Part 1 in the description below, or if you wait till the end of the video, there will be a link there as well. The material in this video covers the 6.0 version of the Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks course. I want to thank you for watching my videos. Your time is appreciated. If you find the material helpful, you can subscribe to my channel. And remember to click the notification button if you want to see when I post new content. If you have any questions, you can leave a comment below. And if you do watch to the end of the video, I will have links to the previous chapters on this. Okay, so let's take a look at Chapter 11, Build a Small Network, Part 2 of 2. So we're going to look in Part 2 at the basic network performance. We're going to look at using the output of the ping command to establish relative network performance. We're going to look at the tracer command. We're going to look at using the show commands and use host and IOS commands to acquire information about network devices. We're also going to take a look at network troubleshooting in this video. So let's get started with 11.3, basic network performance. Now, when we do the ping command, on Windows side, you've got ping is a little bit different than when we're using Cisco devices. So we use the ping command. It is an effective way to test connectivity after you've set up IP addressing and that to make sure that everything is connected properly and working. You want to use the ICMP or the Internet Control Message Protocol. It uses the ICMP to verify layer 3 connectivity. That's what the ping does for you. So helping to identify the source of the problem is another thing that it does, because if it only pings so far, and you try to ping an address and you don't get anything back, you can then ping, and let's just say I'm going to use an example here. So let's say I have an endpoint here and I have a switch here and I have a router here and I have another switch here and I have another endpoint here, and I try to ping across over to this one. Well, it doesn't go through. Well, then I can ping back, and I'm going to say, okay, I always work forward. I always ping this endpoint first and say, okay, can I ping here if I've got a VLAN set up? But can I ping my IP address here on this side of the router? Can I ping this side of the IP router? Then can I ping the endpoint? Can I get to where I need to go in there? So that's a way that you can test or find the source of the problem. Now, what do the common ping indicators tell you? A bang sign, or exclamation, a point, or a U, capital U. The exclamation indicates a receipt of an ICMP echo reply message. A period indicates a time expired while waiting for the ICMP echo reply message. And a capital U indicates the ICMP had an unreachable destination or unreachable message was received. You also have extended ping, and those allow for more options, but those go beyond the scope of this. Go into your NETACAD course in Chapter 11, and you're going to read more about the extended ping in this chapter. Now, when you set a network baseline, what is a baseline? It's where, and I think we've talked about this in previous chapters, where we try to set a baseline and say what's normal for the system. So we build a baseline over a period of time. We run some series of pings and we say, okay, what's normal for this network during different times of the day? What's an average ping time? You know, what's an average reply? You save those results from the command, such as the ping or trace, along with any error messages you get and response times, and you save those, and then you can go back and analyze them later. So if you start having network issues, you can go back and say, okay, what's my baseline? What should it be? You also timestamp it for later comparison, and then increased response time could indicate some kind of latency issue, and it could say, okay, my response time is moving up here for some reason. Why is that? And you can start to diagnose that based on your baseline. Now, when we interpret trace messages, a trace message, it returns a list of hops as a packet is routed through a network. So as it goes through, so we do a trace from a host, and we trace 10.1.0.2, and we trace it. And so it starts going up, and it says, okay, well, here's my first hop point here. You know, here's my first hop point, and then the next hop point, and so forth on through, all the way through. So when we did 10.2, we did this one here. We were tracing this one here. So it shows me my hop points. And over here, so it says over a maximum of 30 hops, we got a reply back, but then we got request timed out. And then we can maybe start using ping to figure out why it timed out. But we use tracer for Windows-based systems also. And then trace route is for Cisco iOS and Unix-based systems. So tracer's on Windows, trace route is on Cisco and Unix-based Linux, so forth. Now, extended trace route allows adjustment of parameters. The command terminates when the destination responds with an ICMP echo reply, and the user interrupts the trace with the escape sequence. So it will go through, and you can do those commands with it. You can it's got some extended ability to it. The Cisco IOS command line interface, or CIL, show commands are powerful troubleshooting tools because you can gain a whole lot of information from your system by using the show commands. The show command displays configuration files, checking the status of device interfaces, processes that are happening, verifying the device operational status, and many more. So the status of nearly every process or function of a router can be displayed using a show command. So your show commands are one of the things that you really – there's some basic ones that you really just need to memorize for this course. You're just going to need to know them, and you need to memorize them. Like show running config, you're going to memorize show running config. That's just one that you do a lot. You know, show interface, you're going to do that one a lot. And so depending on your interface, you know, like interface so you can come back and see your – that's running config, but that's going to show your information. And when you have to look up an interface configuration and those things like that, there's certain ones that you're just going to memorize over time, but they are important. You're not going to need to memorize all the show commands, but there's some basic ones that you're going to need to know. Some more of the popular show commands are show running config, interfaces, ARP, IP route, protocols, versions. I'm telling you, these are the ones you're going to use a lot in this course in particular, but you are going to be using, and you do need to know the different ones, you know, show your ARP, show your IP route protocols and version. You'll use show version quite a bit too when you're configuring a device. Now the IP command or the IP config display, I call it IP config for short. That's just my nickname for it. It displays the IP and default gateway information on a Windows-based computer. And so if we do the IP config, it's going to give you your basic information here. If you do the IP config all and ask the question, what do these commands display? So IP/all shows you all of the information for the IP configuration. The display DNS is going to give you your DNS information, your DNS table that's been built locally on that Windows machine. So it's a powerful tool as well. The ARP command, if we do ARP space dash lowercase a, that command lists all devices currently in the ARP cache. So you can check your ARP cache on there, and you can see what, you know, what's being connected on the ARP table. The cache can be cleared by using the ARP D command. So if you want to clear that cache out, if you're having trouble with the ARP table, usually you don't deal with that too much, but that is something that you do need to know for this course. The show CDP neighbors command is a Cisco proprietary protocol. It runs at the data link layer. Two or more Cisco network devices can learn about each other, even if the layer 3 connectivity does not exist. So CDP can be a security risk, though. So to disable CDP globally, you use the global configuration command and you say no CDP run. And to disable CDP on an interface, you use the interface command no CDP enable. And the show CDP neighbors detail command reveals the IP address of the neighboring devices. So again, it can be a security risk, so you can turn that off. And you'll learn more about that in your reading for this chapter as well. The show IP interface brief command, show IP interface brief command, gives a summary of the key information for all the network interfaces on a router. It verifies the status of the switch interfaces, and it's another powerful command that you're going to use. You need to memorize that one. That's just another one that you'll need to memorize for this course. The debug command, you won't use this one as often, but you will use it in this course, and you do need to know what it's about. It allows the administrator to display messages generated by the following processes in real-time analysis, what iOS processes are running, protocols, mechanisms, and events. And then undebug all turns off all debug commands. You're usually going to run that when you're having some kind of problem or you're trying to set a baseline on your system. Now, the terminal monitor command displays the log messages while connected remotely, such as SSH, and you can stop displaying the log message by using the terminal no monitor on your Cisco device. All right, so let's take a look at 11.4 network troubleshooting. So basic troubleshooting approach is you want to identify the problem, you want to establish a theory of probable cause, you want to test the theory to determine the cause, you want to establish a plan of action to resolve the problem and implement a solution, and then you want to verify full system functionality, you want to implement preventative measures, make sure it's not going to happen again, and you want to document your findings. your actions and your outcomes. You want to document that. So if you've taken the ITE, and I would highly recommend taking the IT Essentials course. In the IT Essentials course, you cover this very extensively, this troubleshooting approach here. It applies across all of IT. You want to identify the problem, establish a theory of probable cause, test the theory. Let me do this. Identify the problem, establish, test, establish a plan of action, verify functionality, and document your findings. If you take the ITE course, you're going to memorize that. So I would highly recommend just go ahead and, you know, memorizing this, or, you know, make sure that you fully understand what you're doing here with your basic troubleshooting approach. And at some point, I learned a very good lesson in IT early on about resolving and escalating. I was working on a problem and I was just, you know, could not figure it out. And it was like 30 minutes into it, you know, 45 minutes into it, an hour into it. And I just kept working, trying to figure it out. And I had another coworker, and they gave me a good piece of advice. And they said, after a certain amount of time, it's going to cost you more money to continue working on that than to escalate the problem. So we called in somebody to fix the problem, and they got it fixed fairly quickly. So at some point, you need to establish, when do you resolve and when do you escalate? If you cannot get something resolved in a certain amount of time, how quickly do you escalate the problem? And so you need to – that's usually in your security plan. That's usually in your IT plan. But you need to have a pretty good idea of when you're going to escalate. And then when we talk about verify and monitor solutions, if you put a solution in place, one, make sure it's going to work. You don't want to do any more damage. You don't want to cause more downtime, things like that, by trying to put a solution in place. Make sure the solution is going to work. Then you want to verify it works and then monitor it. So what iOS commands could you use to verify and monitor the solution? And you want to think about some of those commands, you know, use your show commands to say, you know, is the solution working? Are things connected properly? Here's a chart of the identify the problem, establish the theory, test the theory. I'm going to leave this up here just for a second, or you can pause your screen if you want to get a screenshot of it on there. But that's a good plan of action, the six steps there. Identify, establish, test, establish a plan of action, verify functionality, implement measures, and then document. All right, so troubleshooting cables and interfaces, duplex operation, make sure that you check that, the direction of data transmission between two devices. Sometimes you have full duplex on one side and a single duplex on the other side, and you can have problems with that. So two connected Ethernet network interfaces should operate in the same duplex mode for best performance. Log messages can indicate duplex mismatches. And there are iOS commands that you can use to determine the duplex mismatch. They're not given here in this presentation, but you can find those in the reading. But if you do have, you know, single duplex on, or if you have a single on one side and full duplex on the other side, it's going to give you problems. Now, IP addressing issues on an iOS device, manual assignments can cause mistakes because you can put in the wrong IP address. So you want to make sure that when you're putting in your IP addresses, that you manually double check those and verify those and make sure that they're put in properly. You could have DHCP related issues. Sometimes that happens, and you might need to reboot your DHCP, clear all the DHCP cache out, and, you know, tell your IP address to release and renew. You might have to do a release and renew command on the input devices. And then which show commands, and we're looking at one down here, show IP interface gigabit Ethernet. That's one right here. Gives us Ethernet address, and it shows us the broadcast address, and then it gives us our basic information. But when you're putting in your information, you want to make sure that when you're plugging it into, when you're typing it into that router or that switch or that Cisco device, that you are putting it in properly. Because otherwise, you're going to have problems with it. Now, IP addressing issues on end devices, that would be, you know, like a Windows machine or another device. On a Windows-based machine, if it's not getting an IP address, it's going to get the 169.254 range. IP config to verify IP addresses assigned to the Windows-based system. You can use ipconfig to make sure, you know, it's got a good IP address here and it's got the right default gateway set up. If you don't have DHCP, you can have problems by plugging in manually, so you want to make sure that you check those on end devices. And you all can also have default gateway issues, and so you can use the ipconfig on there to look at your default gateway to and you can ping your default gateway to make sure it's working as well. So if you say, okay, well, my IP address is there, but it's still not going through, well, ping that IP address for the default gateway to see if it's going to get through, and you might have some kind of issue there as well. Now, when you're troubleshooting DNS issues, you can use the ipconfig/all to determine your DNS server. And this is one right here. And so then you get your DNS information down here. So your DNS server down here, and you can check that, maybe ping that. You know, you might try to ping it to see if you can get to it. NS lookup is manually place DNS queries and analyze DNS response if you do the NS lookup. And you can also do the, you can flush your DNS cache as well if you're having problems with that. That's another way to do that. All right, so this has been Chapter 11, Part 2 of 2, and we've looked at using common show commands and utilities to establish a relative performance baseline. We looked at applying troubleshooting methodologies and command host and iOS commands, and we also looked at how a small network of directly connected segments is created, configured, and verified, and we can verify that using the ipconfig or the ping command and so forth. So this has been a two-part Chapter 11, so check out Part 1 if you got to this video first. The link is in the description below, or if you hold on just a few seconds, you'll see it at the end of this video. But I hope this video series was helpful for you. Chapter 11 does conclude this series. Make sure that you check out my YouTube channel for the other playlists for other videos that I have out there. I also do some gaming videos, so I'll put a plug in for that. But I do hope these videos were helpful for you, and I hope you have a great day.